Very good morning to everyone. You're all very, very welcome this morning. The Ballyclare Baptist Church. And there's an awful change and an awful lot of people I can see. An awful lot of short hairs. Praise the Lord, we all were able to go to the barbers, hairdressers. It's great. It's lovely to see you all here this morning. Before we go any further, we'll come before the Lord in prayer. Thank you very much. Our loving Heavenly Father, we come into your holy presence this morning with grateful hearts. Father, we thank you for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who came into this world to take away the sin of this world. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the many benefits and blessings you have bestowed upon us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for this wonderful, wonderful day that you've given to us. It's a day that you've made for us, and we will rejoice in it. This morning, Heavenly Father, we thank you for our brother Andrew has come along to speak to us. We ask, Almighty Father, that you will indeed bless him. You'll speak through him, Heavenly Father, that we will leave this place changed people, knowing of a certainty that the Lord Jesus Christ has spoken to each one of us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, there's many within the fellowship who were out, weren't able to come out, and are out now. And Heavenly Father, we also think of those that can't come out yet. We ask, precious Father, that you'll come upon them. You'll give them a blessing this morning. That, Heavenly Father, they will know of a certainty that Jesus Christ, your Son, Heavenly Father, is round about them. His arms are upholding them, uplifting them. And Heavenly Father, we bring before you our brother Sammy. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that he's come out of the hospital and he's doing fairly well. We ask, Almighty Father, you'll continue to bless him and strengthen him in the days that lie ahead. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that the Sunday school is about to begin again. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that the boys and girls can come and hear the gospel. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the boys and girls will hear, after such a long time, they will hear the Lord Jesus Christ is alive. The Lord Jesus Christ loves each one of them. And Heavenly Father, we ask that you'll bless the teachers and those that lead the Sunday school today, that the boys and girls will indeed leave this place knowing Jesus Christ is their friend. So, Heavenly Father, we ask you'll continue to bless us. We ask you, God, for a blessing upon our drive-in this afternoon. And Heavenly Father, for a sister, Victoria, that's coming along to sing. We ask, precious Father, we'll have a glorious, wonderful time there. It'll be a busy place, Father. We love to be busy in the Lord's work. And we know, Heavenly Father, you're in it and you're blessing it and giving us strength through it. So be with us throughout the rest of this day. For we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now, we're going to not sing again. It's up on the screen. And this is a very special hymn to myself, my dear wife, and to Gillian as well, because we sang this at our weddings. And at my wedding day, when I sang this many years ago, I didn't realize the depth of that song. I do now. So whenever it's played and you see the words, please keep it on your heart. Thank you very much. Thank you, Gillian.
Thank you.
That's great. Thanks very much, Gillian. Brings back great memories. Now, our reading this morning has taken from Psalm 51. Psalm 51. Reading from verse 1 to 13. Psalm 51. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold with me thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Amen. And we know that the Lord will indeed bless this reading. Now, the children, the boys and girls, here's a question for you this morning. Now, you have to be very careful when you put your hand up this question. And the question is, who got washed this morning? Now, be careful. If you don't put your hand up, the people might leave beside you. They might like to sit beside you if you haven't got washed. So, who got washed this morning? Is there nobody in Ballyclare Baptist Church that gets washed? No children? No. My goodness gracious. Well, sometimes getting washed doesn't clean you properly. I know whenever I'm out in the garden doing a lot of work in the garden, or maybe under the car, you come in, your hands are really, really dirty. It's hard to get them clean. You scrub them with as much cleaning material as you can get, and they still don't get clean. And then maybe later on in the evening, your hands start to get clean. They eventually do get washed. Well, it reminds me of an incident that happened whenever I used to be in the fire service many years ago. We were called out to an accident on the High Town Road. That's the road between Glengormley and Belfast. And there used to be a really twisty, hilly road. We're called out to an accident. And when we got there, a van had crashed into a lady's car because they didn't see each other in the hill. The lady, we got the lady sorted out okay, no problem at all, got her out of her car all right. But we went down to the two gentlemen in the van that they were driving. And such a sight. It was dreadful. It was terrible. It was. If you had went there, you wouldn't have been happy at all to see what we seen. Because these two gentlemen were painting contractors. And these two gentlemen crashed into a tree. And every paint tin in the back of the van had come shooting forward and round the two of them. They were absolutely covered in all colours of paint, from head to toe. We had to get them out. They needed washed. They needed cleaned. And certainly that evening, I'm sure they got well washed and well cleaned. But you know, sometimes you just can't get cleaned enough. There was one time in my life when I was so dirty, so filthy, that I couldn't get cleaned. No matter what I did, no matter how hard I washed myself, I couldn't get cleaned. And the only way I could get clean was to realize that the dirt that I had in my life was not just ordinary dirt. It was the dirt of sin. And I was full of sin, just like everybody. When they're born, all the boys and girls, you're born with sin in your life. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he can take away that sin. You know, God won't let you into heaven if you're not clean. It doesn't matter how good you are. It doesn't matter how wonderful you treat other people. if you have not got that sin washed away, as the reading said, you must be washed. If you haven't got that sin washed away, God doesn't want you in heaven. So maybe this morning you'll remember about those two poor men that were covered in paint that needed washed. But realize that you need washed more than anybody with dirt on them needs washed, because you've got sin. And we know that there's many boys and girls here this morning have indeed asked Jesus Christ to come into their lives, to take away that sin, and thank God for it. But we know there are people, even listening now, maybe not in this church, but somewhere else are listening, that they need Jesus Christ to come in. So remember, God doesn't want you if you've got sin, but God loves you to ask Jesus to come in and take that sin away. So please remember to get washed in the blood of the Lamb. Thank you very much. Now we're going to sing a chorus. Well, we're not going to sing again. A chorus for the boys and girls. It's 329. It's in the white book. And it's, praise him, all you little children. God is love. Hope and pray everybody thanks God for their salvation in this place today. Now the announcements we have for the incoming week. Our speaker today is our brother Andrew Daly from Lurgan, and he's very, very welcome this morning. First time I think you've been here, yes? Good, so everybody, if you see him on the way out, just say hello to him. You'd love to see a smiling face. And he'll be with us again at 6 p.m. for the drive-in service, along with Victoria Salt. Now she's coming along to sing a couple of pieces for us this evening. So if you can, please make it along at 6 p.m. But be very careful when you're coming in for the service this evening, because the Sunday school, it's starting at 5 o'clock today. This is the first time it's back. So pray much for it during the day, and also pray for it tonight whenever it's on at 5 o'clock. It's on from 5 to 5:45. Please remember the missions we support from the church, and also our brother Stevie Blair. Now Stevie is very busy at this time with Shining Lights, so please pray much for him, that the boys and girls in all the schools will hear the gospel and Stevie will have strength to bring it to them. On Tuesday night at prayer time at 8 p.m. we will be back in the church hall again, and the speaker will be Jackie Hughes. The next Lord's Day, the speaker at both services will be David Good. Now, we know in past that David Good has been very ill, and David is coming along. Still okay, Stephen? Yes, still okay. David Good's coming along next Lord's Day, so we know the Lord will bless him. And please remember to bring your own emblems for the Lord's table when we come. But after this morning's service, there will be the Lord's table. All who are walking in fellowship with our Lord are invited to stay and remember him in his own appointed way. All women are requested to have their heads covered in accordance with the scriptural pattern. And also please, as we say every week, please adhere to social distancing at all times and wear face coverings. Thank you very much. Now, our brother is going to bring the Lord's word. Thank you.
Well, good morning. It's good to be with you this morning. And we're taking our Bibles, please, and turning to Genesis chapter 5. And while you're finding the place, I want to thank Michael for his kind words of welcome, and to Stephen and the church for their invitation. It's a great privilege for me to be with you today, ministering this morning and preaching it tonight. And do remember the drive-in tonight. It would be good to see that car park well filled. And even if the preacher's not up to much, I can assure you the singer is one of the best in Ulster. We're turning to Genesis chapter 5 this morning, and I want to talk to you about Enoch, a man who walked with God. And we'll break in at verse 18, please. Genesis 5:18. And Jared lived 162 years, and he begat Enoch. And Jared lived after he begat Enoch 800 years, and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. And Enoch lived 65 years, and he begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years, and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. And then turn over with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Someone wisely said that the best commentary in Scripture is other parts of Scripture. And here in Hebrews 11, we have the commentary on the passage we've just read. Hebrews chapter 11, and we'll just read verses 5 and 6. By faith Enoch was translated, that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation he had this testimony, that he pleased God. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And we'll end there at verse 6, knowing the Lord will add his blessing to his word. You know, epitaphs tell us a lot about a person whenever they die. To many, it's their final words to the world and what they want to be remembered for. To others, families put that epitaph in the gravestone as a lasting memory of their dearly departed loved one. Some are very humorous, like the headstone in a Pennsylvania cemetery that read, "Here lies the body of Jonathan Blake. Stepped on the gas instead of the brake." Others sum up the life's work of an individual like C.H. Spurgeon, who has those words of 2 Timothy 4 and 7 inscribed in his gravestone, which says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith." That's a very appropriate scripture for as a tribute to a man of great stature like Spurgeon. But what we read in Hebrews 11 this morning, that's an even greater epitaph. An epitaph that came directly from the mouth of God, summing up the life work of one of the great heroes of the faith, Enoch, a man who walked with God and a man who pleased God. Enoch isn't like Abraham or Moses or Jacob, who are also in that list in the Hall of Faith of Hebrews 11. There aren't really vast passages of narrative about the life of Enoch, apart from what we've read there this morning in Hebrews 11 and back in Genesis 5, and then in Jude, whenever we learn that Enoch was a prophet. Genesis, of course, is the book of beginnings, and there we learn that Enoch is the seventh from the first man, Adam. You remember how Adam had three sons, Cain, Abel, and Seth. And you'll remember how Cain killed Abel, and Cain's lineage then became that evil line that we read of in Genesis 4. But now in Genesis 5, we see this righteous bloodline of Seth. We have a genealogy stretching right down from the first man, Adam, down to Noah's sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Look with me, please, at the genealogy just there in Genesis 5. For there's one sad refrain that runs the whole way through this chapter. Look at verse 8. And all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. Look again at verse 11 at the end of it. And he died. Verse 14. And he died. The whole way down through this chapter, there's this phrase, "and he died." It's as if God is calling out Satan and the devil for exactly what he is, a liar from the beginning. You remember that the old serpent told Eve that if she ate of the tree, ye shall not surely die. But here in Genesis 5, we're told, "and he died, and he died, and he died." But in the middle of that gloomy obituary column of Genesis 5, we see Enoch. He broke the pattern. He broke the mold because he was not, for God took him. He didn't pass through the article of death before going to heaven because he was raptured. You know, there's only been two people that can say that they've never went through the article of death before going to heaven. Enoch, and then the other was Elijah. You remember how Elijah was caught up by the chariot of fire into heaven? These two men were bodily taken from this earth into heaven, for they were raptured. They might be the only two that this has happened to before, but they set the pattern for what will happen in the last days, whenever millions are caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and the rapture of the church, and we'll think about that just a little later on. But what I want to focus the most of our time on this morning in these verses that we've read in Genesis 5 is this wonderful life cycle of a believer. Because you see, in verse 22, which we read, we see Enoch's salvation. And then in verse 24, we see his sanctification. And then in verse 24, we see his translation or his glorification. And those are the three headings that I want us to look at this morning as we study Enoch, a man who walked with God. Look firstly with me at his salvation. For every walk has to have a starting point, and it's no different from Enoch in his walk with God. Just like you and I, we weren't always walking with the Lord. Look at verse 22. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah. Just like us, Enoch had to come to a point in his life's experience when he had to put his faith and trust in the Lord Jesus for salvation. Incidentally, there was only and is only one way to come to God, whether it was in the Old Testament or whether it was in the New Testament. It's by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. For Enoch and those Old Testament saints, they were saved by looking forward to the cross and the coming of Messiah. We're saved by looking back at the work of Christ and his first coming and his sacrifice on the cross, but it's all because of the work of Christ this morning that we're saved. Enoch came to that point in his life's experience when he put his faith and trust in Christ. You know, there's many people this morning that think that Enoch, or believe that Enoch, came to faith because of the birth of his son Methuselah. And I can see where they're coming from in verse 22. You know, the birth of a child changes many a man. But you can take this or you can leave it. But I believe this morning that God revealed himself to Enoch and given that great vision that we see in the little book of Jude whenever he prophesied judgment to the people of his day. You see, Jude 14 and 15 tells us, "And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints, to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speech which ungodly sinners have spoken against them." You see, God gave Enoch this message of judgment to proclaim. And I think Enoch was so struck by this message of judgment that this made him put his faith in God. In fact, he was so consumed by this message of judgment that he called his son Methuselah, which literally means when he is dead, it will be sent. What was going to be sent? It was judgment. It was the flood. His name was a God-given prophecy. And if you do the maths this morning, you'll find out that Methuselah died 969 years after Enoch was saved whenever the flood came. Enoch was made to understand that the death of his son would signal destruction to the world, and Methuselah became this symbol of impending judgment. I mean, can you imagine Enoch and Mrs. Enoch running around the house every time that Methuselah got a sniffle? They thought judgment was coming. But isn't there a stark contrast here? At the death of Enoch's son, the world was going to be destroyed. But at the death of God's only begotten son, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You see, Christ took the judgment upon himself so that you and I wouldn't have to. What a price God paid to redeem you and I from the judgment to come from eternity in hell. Let me ask you this morning, as you sit in Ballyclare Baptist this morning, have you started to walk with God? Have you put your faith in Christ for time and for eternity? Or maybe you come here week by week and like Enoch, you've been told from this pulpit and from other pulpits about the judgment of God. You know that this morning if you were to die without accepting him as your Savior, you'd meet him as judge and you'd be punished in hell for all eternity. My dear friend, this morning then, what is keeping you back? Won't you come to Jesus this morning, the one that loved you so much that he bore the judgment for you and his only begotten Son and died on that cross at Calvary so that you wouldn't have to go through judgment? Just where you sit this morning, you can put your faith in him for time and for eternity. Enoch walked with God, for he came to a point in his life when he trusted God for salvation. But then look again at verse 22. Because we see that Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years. That was Enoch's sanctification. That was his daily walk with God. You see, Enoch didn't just start the walk with God and then fall off. No, verse 22 tells us that he walked with God 300 years. Isn't that amazing for a man to walk with God 300 years? Such consistency. I mean, what an impact some people have whenever they're just saved. They're on fire for God, willing to go all out for him. But then some discouragement comes along or something happens in the church and they write that resignation letter. They become less faithful to the meetings and the fire starts to go out. And then there's others that go on with God and they mature in the faith. And I'm sure you know them, that they're just older saints that are shining lights for God and they radiate the goodness of their God after 50, 60 or 70 years. I remember going to visit my great granny in the nursing home in Tennant Street facing Shankill Baptist. She was one of the longest serving members in the church. And every time we went in to visit her, I was only about 9 or 10, but every time we went in to visit her, we would have read Psalm 23. We started in the Lord's my shepherd, and she was already at the end of the psalm. She was well ahead of us, and she was just someone that radiated the goodness and the presence of God, and that impacted me even as a 9 and 10-year-old boy. She'd been saved for 70 or 80 years. But can you imagine meeting Enoch, a man that walked with God 300 years? How intimate his fellowship with God must have been. How much of God he must have known. And how much he must have just radiated the very presence of God. Well, you say to me this morning, you know, Enoch didn't live in a secular and corrupt society as we did. Really? Bear in mind that Enoch lived in the days of Genesis 4 and Genesis 6. Days whenever it was so corrupt that God drowned the whole of civilization. And prior to the flood, you remember that the Word of God tells us that all the imagination of man was only evil continually. Didn't take long for after the fall for the first murder to happen as Cain killed Abel. Didn't take long for sexual immorality to enter into the world, for Lamech became the world's first polygamist in Genesis 4. He took two wives and thus began the attack in the family unit that hasn't ceased even today. Divorce is now the norm. Homosexuality is actively promoted and promiscuity is no longer frowned upon. It was a day of murder. It was a day of immorality. It was a day of demonic activity, because 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20 tells us that the demons that Christ went and preached to, which were sometimes disobedience, once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah. You remember what the Apostle Paul said, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." There was demonic warfare in Enoch's time. There was immorality. There was murder. And God was going to destroy the world in judgment. And you know, by and by, our times are no different. And we shouldn't really be surprised by this. Because Matthew's gospel tells us, he says, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be." You see, they were eating and drinking. They were marrying and giving in marriage. And the thought of God never crossed their mind. The times were so dark that Enoch lived in. Yet it was against that bleak background that we find Enoch, a shining beacon in the darkness. We find a man walking with his God. Should we not be the same this morning? As pilgrims and travelers in an ever-changing world that just seems to fall deeper and deeper into the pits of immorality each day, should we not stand out to be salt and light in an evil world, preserving the things that we ought to, stinging whenever it's appropriate, and shining light into this darkness? That's exactly what Enoch was doing whenever he walked with his God. I want you to notice a couple of things that are suggested in the text this morning from Enoch's walk with God. Look firstly with me at he walked in fellowship with his God. You know, Amos 3:3 tells us, "Can two walk together except they be agreed?" That tells me that not only was the God Enoch's savior, but he was also his companion that he walked through life with. He wasn't some distant deity, but rather Enoch walked in close and intimate daily communion with God. You remember that there were others in Genesis that had this great communion. It was Adam and Eve. Before the fall, they walked in the garden in the cool of the day, and they talked with God as friend with friend. They had intimate communion. But then came the fall. They were thrown out of the garden, and all of a sudden we find someone who has been reconciled and is now walking in close communion with God. Wonder this morning, are you and I walking in close communion with God experientially? Yes, we've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, and we're saved this morning. We're growing in Christ through sanctification. But maybe this morning, in the nitty-gritty and difficulties of our daily Christian life, you're struggling and you don't feel that intimate presence of God with you. Maybe this morning you're going home to an empty house, and sometimes that loneliness seems unbearable. Maybe you're going into this new week with all its worries and hardships of the business. Maybe you have a hospital appointment that you've been dreading, and those results that may tear your world apart. My dear friends, this morning, can I encourage you to come to the Master, to cast all your care upon him this morning, for he careth for you, and go into this new week renewed and revived by the communion and the fellowship of the very presence of God. To walk in fellowship with God meant that Enoch had to be walking in the same direction as God. Meant that he had to spend time with God, finding out the will of God for his everyday life, for his everyday living. Meant spending time in prayer and in close communion. I wonder, do you and I have a place this morning and a time whenever we get alone with God, whenever we just pray to him, where we worship him, where we read his word and be still and know that he is God and listen to his voice? You remember how the Lord Jesus had to get away from the crowd so often to spend time with his Father. And if that's what the Lord needed to do, how much more do we as mere mortals need to do that? You know, we live in a day and age whenever we don't know what it is to be still. I don't know about you, but during that first lockdown, I had a bit more time on my hands. But then, whenever we came out of that lockdown, the daily grind of life started to get back into that hamster wheel of motion. And it becomes difficult as we walk through life to really spend that time, disciplined time, with God in prayer. We're so busy in the 21st century. Yet Martin Luther, a man who was much busier, I would say, than you and I, he said this: "I have so much to do that I shall spend the first 3 hours of my day in prayer." Wonder, do any of us know about what it is for an hour in prayer, never mind 3 hours? Enoch walked in the same direction as God, but then to walk in fellowship with God meant that he had to walk at the same pace as God. He wasn't to walk any faster than God's timing. He wasn't to walk behind God's timing. He was to walk exactly with God in God's timing. That requires a lot of patience and the ability to wait upon the Lord. You and I like to do things at our pace, and if you're anything like me, you like everything done yesterday. But that's not the scriptural pattern. You remember what the Lord said through Isaiah. He said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." God's timing is always right. And you know, it's lovely to spend some time and track the hand of God through your life. Sometimes we don't understand the way God leads us or the timing that God does things, but his way is always perfect. Enoch walked in fellowship with God, but he also walked in faith, because Hebrews 11 verse 6, which we read, says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." We know that Enoch pleased God because he walked in faith. And from what we studied earlier, we've seen that Enoch had saving faith, but Enoch also had sustaining faith in the everyday, in the nitty-gritty of life. And you know, it's amazing whenever you think back to the likes of Enoch, because he didn't have the same amount of revealed revelation in the Bible that we have today. But I can imagine how he pleaded the promises of God. And you know, as believers, that's what we must do as we go into this new week. Those promises of God, like, "I will never leave thee nor forsake thee," whenever the world walks out. Those promises to cast our care upon him whenever our burden just seems too heavy for us to carry. Wonder this morning, are we walking in fellowship with God? Are we walking in the same direction as God, is at the same pace as God? And are we walking by faith? If we can honestly say before God from the bottom of our hearts the answer to that is yes, well then shouldn't we be hungry for more of God? You know, I was preaching one Sunday recently on Exodus chapter 33, and you'll remember that this was just after the children of Israel had built the golden calf and committed sacrilege, and Moses had come down from Mount Horeb, and he had dropped the Ten Commandments, and they'd broken. And he went then to intercede with the Lord on behalf of the children of Israel, and Exodus 33 tells us that Moses communed with God as friend with friend. And then he pleaded with God that his presence would go with him and the children of Israel up into the land. And God promised him his presence. But that wasn't even enough for Moses, because then he said this great thing: "Show me thy glory." Moses had a hunger for more of God. A man who communed with God as friend with friend and had the very presence of God, he always wanted more of God. As Christians, we ought to want more of God. And it's so challenging to us this morning. And ought not our prayer to be the prayer of the words of William Cowper's great hymn: "Oh, for a closer walk with God, a calm and heavenly frame, a light to shine upon the road that leads me to the Lamb." Enoch walked by faith, but I want you to see also that he preached his message faithfully. For whenever we come to Jude 14 and 15, we see the message that Enoch preached. It was a message of judgment to a sin-cursed world. His message would have been repudiated and reviled in that Adamic society, but nevertheless, he preached a message that pleased God. You know, he preached the message that God gave him, irrespective of the response he was going to get. He didn't alter it. He didn't waver on it to make sure it was popular with everything in society. And in our day and age, there's those that want to water down this God-given message. They want to take out the bits that they think are unacceptable and just ditch those parts that are hard to swallow. Yet as a church, we're called to proclaim the whole counsel of God, and we ought to stand and preach the message we've been given because it's not ours to alter. We must do it consistently. You remember what the Apostle Paul wrote to young Timothy, his son in the faith. He told him to preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. You can't have missed what happened in our assembly 2 weeks ago whenever they voted on this so-called conversion therapy bill. Whenever I looked at some of the legislation in it, it does ban prayer with an individual. And the day is coming in Ulster whenever we'll be banned from preaching the message of repentance. In fact, I think one of the MLAs said that homosexuality is not a sin to be repented of. On the authority of God's word, that sin and every other sin is a sin to be repented of. And we must not give in. We must not go weak. We must faithfully discharge our duty like Enoch did. You know, God has given us a message to deliver to a dying world. And let me challenge you this morning, have you personally discharged your duty? When was the last person you told someone about Jesus? You say, Andrew, I'm not a preacher and I understand that, but you don't need to be. We all have a duty to tell our loved ones of this impending judgment. But the good news of the gospel is that Christ died to be their personal savior so that they wouldn't see judgment, but they'd see glory. And I ask you this morning, do you care enough to tell them? Do you care enough to invite them to the gospel meeting tonight as we preach the unsearchable riches of Christ? When was the last time we wept over lost souls? Sometimes I think, you know, we're very comfortable in church and we need to wake out of our slumber and to discharge our duty. We see Enoch's salvation, we see Enoch's sanctification, but look very quickly, because my time is gone, at Enoch's glorification. Turn over again to Hebrews 11, we'll see this better. Hebrews 11 and the verse 5 again, please. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. Dr. G. Campbell Morgan told the story of a little girl who came home from Sunday school all excited about learning about Enoch's translation. She said, Mommy, Enoch used to go on long walks with God, but Mommy, one day Enoch and God, he took an extra long walk and they just walked on and walked on until God said to Enoch, you're closer to my house than what you are to yours. Why don't you just come in and stay at my house? And he did. I mean, can you imagine the scenes this day? Mrs. Enoch running around going, where's Enoch? He didn't come home for his dinner. One of the kids pipe up and say, Mommy, I don't know, but Daly's been acting up awful strange recently. Yesterday we heard him sing, this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. No one could find Enoch because God took him up, for he obtained the witness that before being taken up, he was pleasing to God, which literally just means that he was walking with God. After 300 years of walking closely and consistently with God, God raptured him and God took him up. And isn't that just a prelude of what's going to happen to God's people someday? One day, and I believe it's going to be soon, the signs of the times are all around. And I believe that some of us, if not all of us, will go through the rapture without dying, because Christ will come to the sky for his bride, his church, and we will be raptured.
You remember what 1 Thessalonians 4 says. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of an archangel, and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. You know, someday there'll be cars going down the motorway without a driver because God has taken the driver. People will wake up and relatives will have vanished out of sight to be with Jesus. Someday millions and millions will disappear and the world won't have an answer. But God has the answer because, like Enoch, it'll be they were not found because God took them up. Wonder this morning as we sit here, are we looking forward to that day with anticipation? Does it motivate us to lead a holier life all out for God? Does it motivate our witness? Does it motivate our prayer, our communion with God? Can we really say from the bottom of our hearts, like John on the Isle of Patmos, even so, come, Lord Jesus? But until that day breaks, can it be said of you, can it be said of me, that like Enoch, we walked with God? Let's bow in a word of prayer. Our Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you that it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished to every good work. And Father, whatever the need is this morning, we pray that by your Holy Spirit that you would apply it to our hearts and to our minds, and that even today we would go out of here encouraged or rebuked or just whatever that need is, Lord. We know that you can meet it. Father, challenge us this morning to bring our loved ones onto the sound of the gospel tonight. And Father, we commit the meeting onto thee tonight, and we pray for the preaching and we pray for the singing, and we just pray that everything would dovetail together and that your Spirit would move tonight, and that even tonight it would be a great day in this church when a soul would come to know thee as Christ eternal. So Father, be with us as we come around thy table. We thank you for this promise that you are coming again, and Father, every time we come around thy table, we come around one more time, but we come around one less time, because it's only till he come. So Father, be with us and continue on with us, we pray. Bless those who must leave us now. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.